Well, praise the name of Jesus. You're listening to Johann van der Hoven, and I'm talking to you about setting up a fellowship of the believers in your area. Today we're going to talk a little bit about the practical side of doing it. Our previous segment dealt with the vision, the purpose, the heart of God, why He wants this new movement to come forth, what He wants to achieve with it in the hearts of people. And it's so important to understand that before even listening to this clip. If you didn't see that yet, I would suggest to you and recommend to you, first go and be informed by that material, by that clip, so that you will understand what the fellowship of the believers is about. Because, you know, there's many reasons for people to do things. Some people just want something for themselves, so they run off and start a whole new church or a home group or whatever the case might be, because they are ambitious, because they are on fire, and they just want to do something for God. But God doesn't want you to do anything for Him. He wants you to do things with Him, and He wants to do things through you. So it's really important to start from the right foundation. If He's speaking into your heart, then respond. If He's moving, then move. But don't just decide, this is a fantastic concept, I'm going to do it because I can do something for Jesus. You're going to miss it by a mile. So we're speaking to people that feel in their heart a quickening of the Spirit to say, I want to firstly be a part of what is happening. In my heart, there's such a deep desire, a craving for more of God and for a greater revelation of His person in my life. And I want it practically so. I don't just want new revelations and hear beautiful things from the Lord that doesn't affect me and that doesn't change my life. You know, the Lord once told me, He said, every revelation will leave you accountable before God. That's a very powerful statement to consider. Every revelation leaves you accountable. In other words, when God shows you something, you become responsible to Him for allowing that thing which He shared with you, that thing which He showed you, to become a living part of your entire being. So we are serious about becoming what our Father envisioned for us to be. We want to yield our lives to Him and say, Father, come and work in me, and do it in a practical manner. I want to see all of you, but not just because you are so beautiful, because I want to become all of you. I want to give myself to you and ask you that your character, your nature, your personality will become a part of my character and my nature and my personality, and that I will be changed by the things that you share with me to become the fruit of those things on earth. Amen. So how do you practically begin a fellowship of the believers in your area? Well, the first thing is, you need to share the vision with people. You need to communicate this with people. You need to tell people that God is doing something so marvelous in this new movement. He's unveiling Himself to people. People are being touched. That's coming together just as a fellowship of the believers. There's no denomination involved. There's no church buildings involved. They're just gathering together in a home, in a hall, wherever, and they are gathering together centered around the person and the presence of Jesus Christ. It's not about a preacher, it's not about an organization, it's just about Jesus being touched by His presence. We just experiencing the revelation that He wants to make known of Himself, and people are touched and changed by that in the most wonderful way. You need to share this with people so that whoever has got the same desire and the same passion as you, and whoever feels the same way in their heart and say, oh wow, I'm so hungry for that. You know, I'm so tired of just religion and church and all of these things. I'm so hungry for God. I just really want Him. I want to lose all of the theatrics and all of the other things and just come to sit at the feet of the Lord and really, truly know His presence and just to be changed by Him. I desire this. Once you share the vision, people that carry that in their hearts will immediately be attracted to what you are telling them. In that way, you're going to find people that's in one accord. Do you remember what happened in the upper room? They were of one mind, of one spirit, and in one accord. And so the Spirit and the power of God could minister to all of them in the same way, because they were all set. All their hearts were set on the same purpose and on the same thing. So you need to find people that has got the same heart than you, the same desire, the same passion, so that when you gather together with those people, that the Spirit of the Lord may minister the same thing in their hearts. Now you may say to me, well, what's the purpose of that? You know, we ought to reach the world. We need to reach unbelievers. You are absolutely right, and I couldn't agree with you more. And the whole purpose of Fellowship of the Believers is not just to gather a lot of believers together for the purpose of just having these great encounters and great experiences in the Lord and not going anywhere with it. But we've got to start somewhere in order for God to equip us by His Spirit, through His Spirit, through His life, through His impartation in us, so that we can go out and present His life to the world. You see, we are able to present His word. That's no problem. There's some really hot preachers out there that can preach up a storm. But we need to be able to communicate the life of God, because that's what changes people. A message can get you really excited and dancing in your seat and happy for a few hours, but the presence of God will change you. The presence of God will transform you. The word spoken by the Spirit that passes by everything logic, that passes your mind, your understanding, your reason, your senses, and that enters your spirit, that word will transform you. And so in order for God to prepare us to truly become vessels of His presence, vessels through whom He can minister to others, we need foundations in our lives to be laid in order for that to happen. So we come together as Fellowship of the Believers, centered around Christ, allowing Him to speak into our lives, to change us into becoming what He originally intended for every believer to be, which is a carrier of His presence, which is a clay jar containing the true life essence of who He is. And once we are there, we have got something that we carry that is true, authentic, and that is Him, not something about Him, but Him, the essence of who He is, that we can take out and pour into the lives of others. And that's the basic principle. Fellowship of the Believers is something that you've got to understand when you begin a fellowship. If there are 10 couples of 10 people that join that fellowship, the idea is not that you keep them there forever, and that 10 more and 30 more and 50 more gets added, and at the end of the day, you got a mega fellowship. That's not the purpose at all. Those 10 people joined, or those 10 couples joined, join with the purpose of being equipped by the Lord, changed, transformed, filled, and equipped and ready for their work of service in the kingdom. That means that every fellowship that contains 10 couples should potentially contain 10 more fellowships, so that the Lord could raise those 10 people up, get them ready, equip them with what He wants to deposit in them, and once they walk in that revelation with Jesus, to free them, to loose them, to release them and say, go now, start up a fellowship in your community. And this is where those in the world come in, because once you start doing that, you start inviting people from your workplace, you start inviting people in the community, you go out and say, listen, can we just knock on your door? Is there something we can pray for in this house? Is there some need? And I can guarantee you, wherever you go, Christians, non-Christians, there are needs, and people will appreciate your prayers. And in that way, we start opening doors. We bring those people into our fellowships, but instead of giving them a religious pep talk, we're actually bringing them into the glory realm of the living Christ that's able to change their lives right there on the spot. Then you see people breaking in the presence of God. You see the Word of God breaking hardened hearts up, and people weeping in His presence coming to Jesus. That's what we need. And the wonder of it is, you are a potential vessel that God's going to use just that way. So you begin your fellowship, firstly, by sharing the vision. Secondly, make it very simple for people to attend. Remember, they're not coming to a church. Make it easy. It's informal. It's about Jesus. We don't have a set program. We don't have a set dress code. We're just coming together, and we're going to just throw our arms into the air, and we're going to start worshiping Jesus and start praying, and His presence is going to come. And as His presence comes, He's going to stir up a word in one of us, and we're going to have a word from the Lord, and something powerful is going to happen in that meeting, and we're all going to go away from there with a mighty encounter from the Holy Spirit. This is totally removed and opposite from the church system as we know it. It has to be organic. God has got to control every single time you come together. So there's nothing wrong in preparing a word as long as it's Spirit inspired. Don't fall into a pattern where we're going to start with a song, and then we're going to have the word, and then we'll do this, and then we'll... Don't go there. Allow the Holy Spirit to work in every meeting as He wills. Some meetings may have no music. Some meetings may have no word. Some meet, you know, there's a whole variety of things that God wants to do depending upon who's there and what the need is and what the foundation is and what the word is that God wants to impart. You need to allow the Spirit of God to express Himself freely as He wills. So that's your objective. You understand now that firstly, what do? We're going to share the vision with people. People are going to get excited and say, I'm in. When and where? Well, now here's the thing. You don't want to start your fellowship meetings at the same time as when the church is having their meetings. You want to make it as easy as possible for people to come and join where you are and what you're doing, and still have the freedom to go to their church if they want to. Remember, your objective and the objective of Fellowship of the Believers is not to take people out of church. That's the Holy Spirit's work. In other words, once God starts talking in them and starts revealing things in them, they're going to see for themselves, my goodness me, but this is wrong and that is wrong. How come this and that? That's God's work. It's not your work. You're not trying to take people away from the church because you're not building one. You are merely a vessel through whom God wants to raise up men and women to walk in His presence and to become effective in His kingdom. Period. If they want to stay in church, join the fellowship and be there, so be it. Makes no difference. We allow the Holy Spirit to have His way, to work in the hearts of people, and to do whatever He wants to do. The only reason they will leave a church building and a church organization is because of the revelation of Christ in their heart to realize it's dead, it's dull, there's nothing going on, there's no life in it, and for that reason, I can't be a part of it. As long as there's a movement of the Spirit, as long as the church is in obedience, why would they leave? So allow God to work in the hearts of people. So here is what I suggest. Have a Fellowship of the Believers evening somewhere midweek that's outside of church time, or have it on a Friday or a Saturday or something like that, that doesn't fall into that time when people normally go to church. And then once you've got people there that don't belong to a church, let's just say some people have already said, man, you know what, I can't be a part of this anymore, I'm so tired of all of this nonsense, I just want to be at home rather than being anywhere else. The moment you've got people there that don't belong anywhere else, then you start a second meeting on a Sunday to facilitate them so that they feel, listen, there's a place for us to go on a Sunday where we fellowship and just come together. But start firstly midweek and let it then grow if it needs to grow. And if there's a cry from the people, if there's a desire in their heart to say, can't we do something on Sundays? Please, you know, I really miss it. Then we facilitate them and say, sure, why not? Let's extend it to a Sunday meeting as well. So my advice, begin somewhere outside of church times. That includes times such as, you know, prayer meetings and whatever else the church has organized. Now, all right, there's a balance in this, because once you start a fellowship, some churches may feel threatened, we've had it, and then they start organizing all sorts of things that they never had before on those particular nights that we have fellowship to prevent their people from actually coming to the fellowship. So you're not going to accommodate that. The moment you've set up a night and it's kind of like neutral, and if something like that happens, you just ignore it and you carry on with what you're doing, irrespective then of whoever may be doing whatever else. As far as Sundays are concerned, as I said, allow that to evolve. Allow it to go there and see when the time comes and you're ready for it, you add a second meeting. Two meetings is actually very good to have. It's very healthy, because you could have one meeting where you allow the word of the Lord to go out, you allow the power of God to work, you know, it's just an awesome service. And you could have the other meeting as more of a fellowship meeting, either allowing the Spirit of God just to flow in worship, praise, and just seeing an outpouring as He leads, of course. Or alternatively, to have a real fellowship with people around a subject where everybody gets to contribute to that specific subject that you're gathering around. Let's say the Holy Spirit. And let's say there are some foundational things that the Lord has shared with us that you now have taken from the website or from wherever, from a DVD or video. Listen to it. It's become a part of you. It's enlightened your understanding. You see things you've never seen before, and you're so on fire with this, and you take this to a fellowship meeting. You say, listen, this is what we're talking about, and you start sharing those things with them, and that starts stirring them, and suddenly the Holy Spirit adds through that one over there, this and this and this, more together with what you're sharing, and another one gets stirred, and they start sharing some things, and maybe there's one with a question, yeah, but how does this work? And God answers that through somebody else. And at the end of the night, you leave there so enriched by what the Holy Spirit has contributed through all of these different people that your basket's just running over. So it's very healthy to have two meetings like that. One where we just open up and allow God to impart into our lives. And the second one where we give the Holy Spirit a chance to involve us in discussing something, or some revelation or some topic, and getting answers. Many people have got questions that they need answers to, but they never get the opportunity to ask them. They never get the opportunity to open up to anybody and to speak their heart and to find the real answers they need in order to move into the next dimension and to grow deeper in the Lord. You'll also find in a setup like that, you're going to have people that's got needs that they otherwise can't communicate, you know? And people sometimes just open up and the Lord can heal them and wonderful things can happen in those meetings. I trust that this second segment has helped you now and that it's linked in nicely with the first one to start giving you an overall picture and a feeling of what Fellowship of the Believers is all about. Until next time, be blessed as you keep walking with Him in the full revelation of His presence in Jesus' name.
My life is not my own. It belongs to You. I belong to You. 'Cause You paid the greatest price to set me free, to redeem me. So now I'm placing everything into Your hands. Take my hopes and dreams and all my 'cause I'm dying to myself so I can live for You, Jesus. I'm gonna live for You. I'm gonna live for You. For my life is to You. I belong to You. 'Cause You paid the greatest price to set me free, to redeem me. So now I'm placing everything into Your. Take my hopes and dreams and all my plans. 'Cause I'm dying to myself so I can live for You, Jesus.